Giller Prize winner Ian Williams wants to open up the conversation about racism. He joins us this morning with his brand new book, Disorientation, Being Black in the World. Good morning.
Hey, good morning.
Good to see you again. You write in this book that race is not an easy thing to talk about. Was it easy to write about?
Oh, absolutely not. So I wrote this beginning last summer. There were justice movements happening. There were wildfires on the West Coast. There was the pandemic coming here. There was a lot going on in the world. But I felt a kind of urgency to tackle the subject.
Right. And you stress in the book that you didn't want to position yourself as an expert in race.
Mm-hmm. Right. So it's, I think there are a lot of, some black writers who claim a kind of authority about it, but I actually think we're all kind of learning, right? We're all trying to figure out where we are in this subject.
Okay. We're trying to figure out where you are in our video as well. So we have the book cover up right now, but yeah, we'll get this figured out, but still we have you on the line. We're going to chat with you. And you say in the book as well, this was another line that I thought was very telling. It's racist to think that race lives only in certain bodies.
Mm-hmm. Right. Absolutely. So we tend to locate race in the black body, right? To think that it's something that black folks have expertise on. And we do have a kind of particular knowledge. But white people are also racialized, right?
My camera issue here. I'm not sure what's going on there. White folks are also racialized. So we can ask white people about their orientation to race, like what's it like being Ukrainian or Russian or what have you, right? And
right.
Not assume that white is neutral and black is somehow exotic and different.
Right. There's also a very telling, you have lots of different experiences that you write about in this book, and it's all different, these all different threads that I found were just fascinating. But you talk about a child discovering, you know, you're going along in life and then all of a sudden realizing that somebody thinks you're different.
Mm-hmm. Right. So this is coming to an awareness of race as a child. And I talk about my niece, who's called the N-word pretty early on in her life, and it totally throws her. And that effect of disorientation, of being made aware that you are different from the other kids, is quite, it stays with you throughout the rest of your life.
Right, and that was by another child, and you think, where did that child learn that?
Absolutely, absolutely. She had to pick up that word somewhere. So what are the conversations that are happening in that home to make that kind of outburst possible for my niece? Yeah, it's unfortunate, but there comes a moment in every racialized person's life where we realize we are different and that somehow white is the standard and we are different from that instead of the other way around.
Right, right. And you also, another line that really stuck out for me is that one black person in the room represents the race, whereas a room of white people only have to represent themselves.
Right, and that's a particular and peculiar burden, right?
Yeah.
And it's kind of like a woman entering a boardroom of men.
Yes.
And everyone turning into that woman and say, so what is the
what do women
sort of
want?
Female perspective on this?
Yes.
Tell us about the entire gender on the planet here. Right. So it's a failure for systems to write to be inclusive and have multiple points of views for many different kinds of people in the room. That's what we see when we're having these sole black representatives.
Right, right. And you really want all people to read this book, right? Because there
absolutely.
Are so many things that we can learn from each other in this.
Absolutely, absolutely. White folks have a contribution to make to the racial conversation, as do all racialized people. So, yes.
Okay. And there's a really telling thread in there about your friend Pierre. We've got about 30 seconds left, but how he was stopped so many times driving his car.
Right, right. I mean, it's become a bit of a cliche now, right?
Yep.
This driving while black kind of situation. But it happens. It happens regularly. It happens unprovoked. It happened to me a few months ago driving with BC plates in Ontario. And, you know, there are folks with Florida plates and Quebec plates and all sorts of things, and they're not getting stopped. So what was different about me in that situation?
Okay. Ian, great to, I would say see you, but talk to you. And your book, Disorientation, it's out now.
So
great read.
Take care. Thanks.